So, yeah, thank you for joining. I already introduced all of today's speakers. Alistair Hudson is new on the stage for today, who is the director of the ZKM. And I prepared a few questions, but whenever you have a question, please raise your hand and we will get a microphone to you. Maybe I would start first with a question that concerns, I think, most of you. Maybe not all of you. In this interdisciplinary round, it was very difficult to find questions that are relevant to all of your practices. But indeed, in the work of all of you, there are methodologies in the development processes. And maybe you all work with interdisciplinary processes and approaches. So how do these different disciplinary approaches and methodologies of your fields eventually overlap? Do you, if any of you, see synergies, like throughout the talks you might have reflected on your own practice through the practice of another speaker? And for me, the main question is, how can we learn from each other in on a methodological level? So maybe it's quite an abstract question, but I don't know who would like to start.
I have an idea. Mm-hmm. Maybe. What I thought about today, when I was in the exhibition with you, and then after hearing the talks of you guys, that one. One topic that we are talking about today is the topic of the model and the topic of the experiment and the topic of the simulation. Mm-hmm. And this is something that struck me today when actually engaging with the exhibits in the exhibition today that I have seen for the first time in person. Today, that these are, well, methodologies that are present in almost any exhibit. And that's something that maybe unifies all of our work. So that would be my answer or my train of thought here.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. There's another one. Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, and I could add to that to continue that train of thought that it always strikes me that exhibitions are a really old-fashioned way of operating. You know, they kind of date from the middle of the 19th century, and they really haven't changed that much since. Well, actually, if you look at, for example, the kind of research in dark matter, this idea of modelling permutations first that then might become the reality, or several other options, that seems a much more smarter way to work, in a way, than creating this fixed model that then goes on in time and then ends.
No, absolutely. This was, by the way, also the first thing when we met a few weeks ago, the first time here in the exhibition. The language when talking about the digital twin or the simulation of things, this was actually a very similar language, but we approached this very differently. So for us, really, we need a one-to-one, more or less exact model of the real world to try out everything before we spend billions to search things in cool-looking labs or so. But yes, the language was surprisingly similar.
I think that we should do that as well, to simulate first and then realize. But yeah,
I just wanted to say, what? Cool-looking labs? What? No, but I think... yes, what I meant earlier also was like if you think about this maybe diffractive modes of acting, where artistic perspective and scientific perspective can maybe get a bit more intertwined or learn from each other, because I think the artistic approach is rather to be completely surprised by whatsoever will come out of it. And I think, at least it's how I understand natural scientific research. If you enter a paper and you have to think about, okay, what will be probably the outcome, and then you try to make the point how to come there. And I think maybe there is this surprising moment where maybe natural sciences could at least open up, and maybe for the artistic perspective, sometimes a bit more structure is also not too bad. I don't know how how you would back me up here or not.
I mean, coming back to the question of Livia, if I read the concept of the exhibition Renaissance 3.0, you have an impression that really now, praxeologically speaking, we all do the same. Yeah, we are sitting in front of our laptops, producing kind of PowerPoint keynote presentations, perform them on the stage. So at this level, of course, I mean, phenomenologically, it's the same kind of activity. Being a bit more serious. I think it's just like the question we are learning from each other all the time, and I think that's a question of like crossing the boundaries. It's like coming back to the discourse of obsolescence is also something outdated. We are already crossed all the possible boundaries. They don't exist anymore. They're suspended. So I'm just like trying to get what. Where are the boundaries at all? Yeah, I mean, we are just like all the time in this constant process of, let's say, influencing each other on the modes of presentation, but also on the modes of producing, let's say, stuff. Yeah, it doesn't matter what kind of text production we talk about, but it's enormous similarity.
Indeed, but if I may, there has been new methodologies, and there are a few new methodologies suggested in the exhibition Matter, Non-Matter, Antimatter that are gathered there, and they are all based on digital tools. So yes, the medium of the exhibition exists for quite a while, but if it can get twisted by such tools, which have to be developed first, this is the core idea of the matter, non-matter, antimatter exhibition. So. Yes, just a side note, but I didn't want to interrupt. I think Jeremy, you.
I agree with everyone. One thing I think that might be an interesting perspective from a media artist is we don't control and chance are definitely two variables, like you said, that we were playing with. But the new media artist generally, like historically speaking, was actually never thought of it as a fixed form. So it was always considered a living media. And one that was prone to decay and actually to die, because a lot of early media not only had obsolescence but used magnetic energy that was actually like, you know, prone to like demagnetizing, right? Literally, and like the particles that you talk about, maybe that's like part of it, but there was this, you know, invisible force that was going to destroy it. And so there's this idea that like the art actually does not happen here. It happens here in the head, which I think also relates to like, you know, this metaphysics in a way, right? Which is if 80% of the world is unknown, this is also the starting position of the artist, which is we start from the position of the majority of understanding is unknown, and therefore our job is to create the maximum opportunity for all of the humans on the planet to discover that potential energy.
Anyway. I actually want to answer to all. This all resonates with me. I think first, yes, we have a structured approach, but I think most of the huge breakthroughs were by chance, things we did not expect. So Vera Rubin did not expect to see this. This was by chance. We switched on our huge machines and we hope to understand them, but of course we don't, right? I think the good simulations are just the tool to at least get some handle to understand a machine that is twice the large as this room here, right? If you don't have a good idea, this completely fails. But what I also would like to add, I mean, the methodology development is also super relevant in our field. So this takes decades to develop some of the tools And then it's fun to show a nice picture, but in actually there are many people working behind this. Interdisciplinary, by the way, I think we didn't touch this so far so much, right? So working with informatics for us, with engineering. By the way, these experiments, we are 3,000 people on these experiments. This is sociologically not easy to handle 3,000 people with a PhD working towards the same goal.
Yeah, so
3,000 PhDs.
Nice. So the, maybe the unifying thing is really a serendipity that we're all not knowing what we're doing, but in the end something cool comes out of it. Maybe.
Yeah, well, genuine curiosity is important in the, all of our fields then. I would have another question, taking on the simulation idea, since simulation is maybe more relevant in the experiments, Torben, you mentioned, but but there's also a sort of word making happening in computer games, but also one could call it word making. What we suggested through the exhibition models, and if we are at exhibition models, I would maybe steer the topic towards museums. And ask your thoughts about your thoughts about wording and the role of museums in wording, so the creation of new words or word making. So what do you think? What is the role of the, for example, the perfect museum in creating these new words? Is it some sort of speculative fabulation, and or maybe something different? So does the museum show possible societal directions, and how may the different directions in the museum overlap? Whomever who would like to. Thank you.
Well, since I've just taken on a big museum, well, it's not a museum, but it's, you know, it's museum-like. I think one of the issues that we have to consider is that, you know, places like this can't create a world on their own. And if I understand worlding correctly, it's actually about creating an emotional attachment between the subject and the world they live in, or the world that is created, even if, you know, whether it's in a kind of, you know, synthetic experiment, or whether it's in gaming or whatever it is, it's about that emotional connection and how you develop that. And even goes back to, I think the origin of the term is in post-colonial theory as well, which is about how the colonizers would use various tactics to connect with and take mastery over wherever they conquered. So in a way, I think whilst we're not going down that route somewhere like this, what the institution does have to do is to work with people and these technologies in order to kind of create a world that is sort of worth living in. And it can't do that on its own as an isolation chamber anymore. You know, the museum was, you know, conceived as that. It was a kind of grabbing of stuff in the world and making a, you know, an isolated space. Whereas actually now it's the opposite now, where actually these institutions have to connect with the world and kind of operate on a one-on-one scale, you know, which is actually then what technology enables us to do. So I think what's quite nice about some of the things we see in the exhibition are that these are, you know, these are kind of methodologies and tactics with technology that you can use for people to reconnect emotionally with all these different worlds, but they all intersect. And then we have to remember that they can't be in isolation, but they actually all overlap. You know, a bit like the way the sort of world of dark matter, we know kind of should overlap with the, you know, 20% material world. We don't know how yet. It's a little bit the same with the museum. We know how it should, but it doesn't quite do it yet.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Indeed, I was trying to refer to two different types of wording. The one you mentioned in postcolonial theory, that So building up a word through the sight of someone, someone else, through the guidance of a native. But there's another understanding of wording that that is indeed the creation of new words on its own in a and in a processual way. So it's a processual ontology that relates to technology and the theory of technology very deeply. And what I followed up in the through the exhibition as well, that these two types of wordings not necessarily or don't necessarily overlap, although they eventually should. Ludmila?
No, I just like wanted maybe to ask you, Alistair, when you said that exhibition became a kind of obsolete format, I'm just like thinking, what would be the other possibilities? Because I mean, it's a kind of format of precisely to produce this kind of both emotional and aesthetical, let's say, interaction of the subject with a kind of environment which we produce. So, and it's also like a format of the public presentation and public exchange. Yeah, it's a sort of producing publicity. Öffentlichkeit, as you call it in German. So what would you have in mind as a, let's say, other possible format, especially regarding, let's say, the institutional framework of places like Zetkaim? I'm just like asking out of pure curiosity, what would be an alternative to the exhibition?
well, for me, the alternative would be you'd carry on showing art or working with art and artists or working with concepts and materials and people, but you would no longer be constrained by this idea of creating an exhibition, which roots are very much in a kind of power game, and they're wrapped up in economics and you know, social constructions. You know, the history of the exhibition was all about a mode of representation, and for me, we now the step we need to take is to go from a world of representation, which is all about creating the picture, something else outside or something else over there, to a world of operation where we're all in it and it's working and it's doing things in the world in an active sense, no longer just pointing at it. And you know, and I think that's reflected a little bit in some of the things, you know, we heard about the gamification as well, which is about, it's no longer about just speaking to people and talking to people. And you know, the exhibition's all wrapped up in that language of, here's a set of stuff and this is what it is, and it starts and it finishes, then it's gone, then you're on to the next thing. Whereas actually, the way people work in the world mostly is they continually evolve and change and think and revisit and move. And I think an institution should be like that too. And it should be a place that is active and where people come to be active, and they're, you know, kind of embroiled in the construction and making, and it becomes a laboratory, mm-hmm. in effect, in a kind of an old-fashioned sense. I think people used to talk about museums as laboratories in the 80s and 90s, but there was something in that, even if the language is a bit redundant.
But what will you do with the people who still have this kind of strange inertia and the will to come to the museum and to see the stuff? Yeah, to see the exhibition.
Put them in a museum.
Don't want to be active. They want to be, let's say, passive, entertained in a good way. And so, what kind of let's say strategies to deal with this kind of the audience? I mean, because the audience is also very fragmented, or also very manifold in its desires, aspirations, expectations. So how to deal with, let's say, remnants of maybe the older paradigms?
Yeah. Well, I don't think you necessarily have to do away with that paradigm. Mm-hmm. It's still there and you can still do it. You can have, for example, you know, an entity like ZKM operating in the world, doing things, activating, connecting, educating, creating, but at the same time have stuff you can, if you just want to come and see some stuff, you can still come and see some stuff. You know, in the same way that, you know, this exhibition that we have at the center of our discussion you can, in one sense, we were talking about this yesterday, you can come, you know, there's lots of text, there's lots of dense material, but if you want, you can just come and walk through and go, oh, you know, that, you know, Geoffrey Shaw's really cool, I really like that, and then, you know, go on to the next thing. On another level, you can really get involved and start to understand how these technologies work, maybe get involved in developing them. It is a kind of open door. So you don't have to, you can have two things at the same time. You don't have to have replace one with the other.
So we will not we keep to the material. The material will be there after this exhibition as well.
Hanging on the wall, maybe. But one good example, if I understand you correctly, is would be the exhibition open codes that have been shown at ZKM, right? So more in some kind of experiment, an exhibition as a social practice, some kind of system even, and that brings me to video games again, or to games in general, because we have this this concept that is rather old, from the 1920s already, by Johann Heusinger, who wrote this Homo Ludens, a book that is a seminal piece of cultural history and anthropology, and he coined this notion of the magic circle, the so-called Zauberkreis, the magic circle. Every game is constructing a kind of system, a kind of rule-based social system around itself. And if we play a game together, we play, I don't know, we play chess, then we tacitly understand the rules and how this game works. So the actual game is not only happening on the table, on the chessboard, but also between people. And this might be maybe a fruitful idea to understand this exhibition practice as a social system even more.
Just my two cents.
Yes, just maybe a short comment also on that. Because I think it goes in the direction that we have, the idea is to rethink the structures or maybe also the methods of the institution. And maybe, because we're now talking a lot of humans, maybe we can also get an inspiration of the non-human world, because something is what's really striking if you're working with these non-human entities and organisms is that they give a crap about your deadlines, which is really actually one major learning that I got from the whole biodesign field. Because if you try and want to, I don't know, let a chair grow out of fungi, and the fungi is just not ready when you have your due date, then you're screwed. So I think it's the same if you, but if you have your exhibition opening, it's a really serious thing that everything needs to be on point there. And why? But of course, these deadlines are human made, and maybe that's the first thing, like, how can we challenge these structures and these apparently God-given methods, how an exhibition or how this whole structure has to work. So maybe there are some inspirations there from the non-human world speaking. Yeah.
More organic institutional structures.
Living
structures. Living structures.
I'll just say that's called the internet, so.
Welcome to the 21st century, you know, go to TikTok.
The internet is a living structure. And I think artists have practiced on the internet outside of the institutional lens for 30 years now. And a lot of those histories haven't been captured. They've disappeared, just as a fungi might disappear. But there are hundreds, if not thousands, of artists and then millions of people who are contributing to a cultural living organism called the internet every day. So,
but maybe also what Ludmilla, what you said, I mean, there are, the temporalities are overlapping somehow. There are not only artists working with the internet. but I think it's a crucial question how to approach all these different methods, because if there's somebody coming with the painting and it's about insurance, it's about, okay, how light or how bright can the light be, how's the whole the material aspects of the whole stuff, how to deal with that, and I think that's maybe also, I don't know, I cannot answer it, but I think where the whole utopian idea gets becomes maybe a little bump when it's like, okay, how to deal with the matter stuff. The stuff, I think it's all about the stuff that we're talking about.
Stuff and stuff. Yeah.
Oh, stuff and stuff, yeah.
Well, another postulate of the exhibition is that digital objects are as material as physical objects because they are bounded on the one hand, because they are bounded to physical material, but on the other hand, they have certain agency as much as physical objects. And in that sense, it's pretty hard to distinguish between a physical, let's say, exhibition space and a digital exhibition space. This is why also the exhibition model that we conceived are part of a physical exhibition, but they are also available online. So the hybridity and interconnectedness of these two networks or two organisms or two realities or however we call it is vital and is crucial, and it's just something we cannot avoid, probably. And also in this sentence, I refer to maybe something that that cannot be distinguished, the living and the non-living matter. That's maybe the next chapter to matter, non-matter, anti-matter, the living and the non-living matter. And whether there's a distinction between them or there's a trans matter coming after all these matters.
Exhibition opening in 2024 then.
maybe later. yes, so maybe getting back to practicalities as a last question. And to the responsibilities to our fields that are very different from each other. But design and science and also an art center has the task, beside its own research, to sensibilize and to raise consciousness of a certain topic, and I was going to ask all of you about that. So, computer games are quite an issue. They are a health issue, actually. The WHO already declared that computer games can be very harmful, and. How do you make your students conscious about this?
Yes, they can be, I think. First of all, talking about video games is, we cannot talk about the video game. It's not possible because there are hundreds or thousands of different iterations and different games. Actually, you cannot compare, massively multiplayer online video game RPG like World of Warcraft with Candy Crush or Tetris. It's two different, completely different things. But of course, they're bad games, they're good games. And my opinion on the topic is that we have to raise consciousness and to have an ethical understanding of what we are actually doing with the medium. So it's crucial, I think, that video games as media or as a medium are under critical scrutiny, and that they are the producers are held responsible for producing games that are harmful and games that are menschenverachtend. I don't know the English word at the moment. And that's why when I talk to my students about this topic, is that I talk to them about video games as expressive media and artistic media that is capable of showing and expressing everything besides harmful things and so on. So video games can be an artistic medium, but of course there are video games that are really bad, and I don't like them either. So it's about critical scrutiny, and it's about an ethical competence with the medium, I think.
May I also to have a question to you, Stephan, because I was like really largely impressed by the project by Kipchak, out of many reasons, because maybe Doom was the game when my gamer career started and ended on one hand, but also I saw like enormous both educational and psychotherapeutic potential in those kind of games. I know many people who would maybe like to extend this kind of game for their collegial context, so is it possible to develop it further so I can just like run and be the but I mean just like now it would be more serious and more pointed the question. Do you see in this kind of games is it like pure, how should I put it, iconoclastic gesture, or is it a kind of insider joke, or I mean, it's both, of course, but how much can we, let's say, extend this conceptual approach, and with what kind of added value at the end? What is the surplus value?
Well, Arsdoom, it's this project called Arsdoom, and I think, first of all, I think it's a joke. I really think it's a joke, and they meant it as a joke. And Peter Weibel was he loved fun, and he thought that it would be a cool, disruptive idea to take this first-person shooter of that time, 1993. It came out in 1993, and it was, of course, at that time already discussed a lot about why the brutal aspects of the game, can they be harmful or not, and so on. So they took it and they flipped it upside down, and they used it as a joke in order to make a point, and in order to criticize art institutions, I think, and some elitist approach of art as an institution, art as a system, art as a closed space, and the institutions as closed spaces. But the added value in the end is that it introduced a new medium into art history. And that is something something bold, I think, that there was some new medium, the video game as artistic material, that has been introduced by this project, by Peter Weibel and the others, into art history. And of course we see that that here interactive media can be perceived in many different contexts, and that can be an added value too. So this Arsdoom project is something very interesting because it comes from popular culture, this Doom game, right? It was a popular video game at the time, played by many, first of all, teenagers. But they took this popular medium and they recontextualized it as a ready-made, some sort of. And this is, this was some kind of cool, disruptive idea at the time in order to introduce a new medium into art history.
So I'm saying it should be recontextualized, make an update version.
Maybe, yeah. I'm all in. Let's go.
Just a short comment, because also what you said, Livia, about this, what is the responsibility that the institutions have, or also maybe all the, also the professions, I think. What's interesting in gaming, at least not all the games, but what I find interesting in that also comes, it comes to scientific communication. I think the responsibility is to create somehow an affection and emotion where you can reach the people. Because if you look, for example, into arts, it's, I wouldn't say every artist, definitely not, but it's kind of a thing that we have these closed circles, these closed wordings, not worldings, but wordings, where in this ivory tower where no one can access it. So I think it's, if it comes to responsibility, then it's be responsible to be accessible. And then it's like, okay, how to create it and find words to or find a common language, actually. I think that's also something really important, because, okay, of course it's about distinction, and it's about somehow getting money or thinking economical, but also it's about, okay, how to share. And I think that's the challenge, at least, that I see the big challenge in how to approach these issues. Oh, okay.
Well, I was just going to jump in and say there are some really good examples of artists that use video games as sites for performance. Like, and one that would be, just to jump off of what you said, would be Angela Washko, who's an American artist who performed inside of World of Warcraft and gave feminist discussions and seminars, and would approach some of the more chauvinist members of the World of Warcraft community directly in their world, so to speak, to like different worlds. These worlds are operating anyway, and artists are occupying a lot of these sites and actually doing some of this work that is institutional work. But I think that's the tradition, actually, that I would uphold, is the artists working with the institution to help connect those communities to the reality, right? Like, because to your point, the ivory tower can sometimes get so opaque you can't even see, you know, there's no windows left, right?
I have a remark too. There is this concept of citizen science that's engaging, normal people, you and me, into natural science, right? There is this beautiful project called Folded. It's by the University of Washington, and it was actually shown at ZKM in the context of the Global Games Exhibition during Globale. Folded was a game, a puzzle game, that was connected to the servers of the University of Washington's biology department. You could solve puzzles, meaning actually what you really did was to solve fold proteins, you actually, by playing the game, research data was generated, and they even could take this research data, and they really, the real scientists could use it in order to decipher a protein that is responsible for HIV infections in some ape populations. And this is some beautiful concept of taking a popular medium, a video game, remodeling it into a scientific model, actually, and then engaging the outside world with it as a social experiment, reaching out permeating boundaries and bubbles. That's cool, I think.
No, I think this responsibility part of explaining our own research, I was actually surprised, because for us, you guys do so well explaining your research. For us, we live in an ivory tower. We spend a lot of money, a lot of years, and we also try to explain this to the public, and I think we have to. And this is also why we are here, of course. But I'm always surprised that you think you live in an ivory tower. I just wonder where we live then. Because I think your stuff is really, comparably accessible.
It's a concurrating to each other ivory towers, you know. But it's very interesting to observe that any kind of the discussion I observed last time when artists and scientists come together in a panel, it just like ends up in the developing, optimization of the science communication instruments, methods, and it's, I think, generally speaking, of course, popular science is a great thing, and of course, it's enormous potential to, to collaborate at this level. I just ask, what is what is the goal of the science communication beyond normal establishing the discourse of legitimization, and also it has some aspect of course good edutainment. Saying it in a kind of negative sense. It can be very positive quality. But what is beyond and behind? What would be the primary goal beyond just creating this kind of intellectual entertainment on a high scale?
Well, I think there are several aspects. I think one thing that I think personally is very important is kind of what data literacy is. So I think we actually have to educate people about scientific practices. Doesn't really matter if this is physics or biology. I think in the end, the science principles are very similar. It's motivating young people to actually study and not already in school, distinguished that certain groups of people will never end up in academia. I think these are all the other aspects, in addition to this edutainment, of course.
In a way, it's a form of involvement as well, isn't it? It's not just you speaking to and justifying your your gigantic funding models and so on as well, but it's actually about bringing people in and people feeling part of it. And I think it's when it's the same with the citizen science thing or with kind of more participatory practice in art, if people feel like they're contributing and joining in, that creates a better social pact and it creates a better energy. Where people are actually in it and enjoying it, for their own sense, even curating in the perfect museum. I was going to have marble floors installed, by the way, after this.
I have a weird question though, because I'm not involved in the science community at all. But points made earlier, we're pointing at in the art institutional context, we're starting a journey into decolonization that we're only a few decades into, but. Do you guys have conversations about decolonizing particle physics, or how does that happen?
That's a good question. That's a good question. So what exactly do you mean with decolonizing
physics? You're a white man of a certain age, standing on a stage in front of people telling them this is the truth about the world, and I'm going to blow your mind, right? I satirized that somewhat as well. And I think you did a really great job, by the way, so it's not about you. But it's just in that context... how do you, because we're talking about human understanding, who gets to decide what human understanding is?
No, okay, this is a very relevant point. I think we are trying there. The challenge in these kind of sciences that this is we need high-tech industries around this, which is, almost automatically right now, meaning you do this research in the US, in Europe, or in Japan, China and Russia, similar but kind of a little bit disconnected. I think we are trying to engage other countries. Africa, for example, is for us, there is almost nothing happening. Asia, apart from Japan and China and India, is also not much happening in our front, but I think it's very hard because we need this high-tech industry around us. Not taking away here my responsibility, but...
So it's embedded in capital?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. That's even, we can get even more complicated.
It's worse, yes.
Yeah, that's a spiral for sure. But
that's not the best last word, unfortunately. although it was a great answer. That's true. At this point, I would open up the discussion and ask if anyone has a question for... A remark? Yes? Oh, yeah. Okay, perfect. Thank you, Felix.
Okay. Thank you. Hello. I'm an art mediator here at ZKM, and I've got lots of experience guiding people through this exhibition, and the people are always blown away by, wow, that's so cool, because, for example, this exhibition, it ends tomorrow. Yes. And the people who visited my guided tours today, they said, oh, I'm so lucky I was able to experience this exhibition. And maybe that's the point. I've always get these kind of questions. Okay, can I visit other exhibitions that took place at the ZKM in any form? Or is there any access to these exhibitions who are not longer here to visit for them? And because my question for you is, how will you implement these tools and these ideas that you developed at the project Beyond Matter and at this exhibition? Will you take these tools and implement them at the future exhibition making and at the to the operating ZKM working space to ensure that people can access exhibitions that have passed? Is there any plans or projects to implement the tools that you so with a lot of effort created and did research about? What's the plan?
Thank you for the question. It's very relevant. And certain tools will definitely feed in the operation, not only of the ZKM, since it was a collaborative project, and there were tools similar to ours developed at other partners, and these tools will be used also by the partners. Specifically, we will release so-called generic exhibition platform that is based on the software we created for Iconoclash, and this will enable other studios, curators, museums who would like to create their own exhibition models to do so. So it will be open source and it will be available online. So we were not just thinking of the ZKM, but on the entire community. Yeah, that would be my answer for that.
May I ask also you the question? I have to out myself as a very old-fashioned aesthetical experience fetishist. but the question is, what do you think, where are the limits of, let's say, digital archiving and reconstruction of exhibitions, which are also like spatial, temporal, etc. experience? So, It's great for me if I go to the beyond, it's not a critique, it's just an observation. It's great if I go to the exhibition and I can put this virtual reality set and see a kind of reconstruction of like possible speculative reconstruction on how it did it look like in the Elisa material. But the question is, where would be the, let's say, the limits of this approach, and what would be also other possible forms of conserving and restoring these forms of experience?
I can briefly answer that I don't know. But it's a beautiful research question for the next round.
Surely the next step is hybridity, isn't it?
It is already there.
Yeah. So, but that needs to be developed more. So in a way, there's still a limit in terms of the functionality, of the accessibility, the language of these kind of system, these tools that are being created. So they need to be developed more into the future. But at the same time, there's an enormous capacity for those to work with physical collections, you know, and there's people I know, artists and programmers now working on this hybridity question, where you can kind of take artifacts from the museum, kind of remediarize them, send them out into the world, hybridize them with things in people's lives to make new objects, send those back into the museum, you know, really play with the material of collections and objects in new ways that we haven't really, really tested yet. And I think it's, the technology is always your horizon line, and its practical application is always the horizon line. So I think we have to keep pushing that to make sure that we're actually doing it as well. You know, and that does mean following through on a lot of the things that have grown through this project.
Hi, I have a question. Thank you very much for the discussion.
As an architect, I'm very curious, what is your special spatial experience? We'll be dealing with doppelgangers or digital twins and physical twins for a very long time, as they are our tools and a medium also. And I'm very curious, what is your special experience when you are building these models and these experiments and this simulation, as you said, for example, in gaming or as a media artist, when you put marble as a texture, is there an understanding of the material? Is there an understanding of the spatial experience? Or when you do, for example, experiments with biomaterial, is there also an understanding of the spatial experience? Or in a sense, can it become more than just a, just an experiment? Thank you.
I'll just very quickly address the marble issue. I mean, for me as an artist, obviously I don't like the material properties of marble in the virtual space are nowhere near what they are in the virtual space, but that's the opportunity, obviously, for play and for irony, right? Like, because we're talking about permanence when we talk about marble, right? This thing that'll last centuries. And then to bring that in the digital space is like a specifically an ironic gesture in my case. So I don't know if that's going to tie in, but we'll see.
Yeah, I think if it comes to biomaterials and the built environment or architecture, I think that's a that's a completely other big topic. But I mean, there the thing that we approach there is like that biomaterials in themselves, qua their definition, they are in the best case also biodegradable, and then we have this conflict with long lasting. Which we want somehow our houses to be, if we don't want them to fall apart in the next rain. So to implement like alternative biomaterials, there comes a lot of research and also repetitions, testing. That is something, for example, we cannot deliver in that lab. If we call it a lab, it's a social lab, not a classic lab where you do these testings. But if you want to implement a new material, for example, like mycelium, like fungi, and mycelium as a building material, they have to do a lot of testings. And of course, there are limits, but I guess the idea goes the same a bit in the same direction that we discussed earlier about what is actually building, what is this whole architectural understanding? Can we rethink the way our houses work? So if we want to implement new materials, but it's a lot about material and biomaterials, of course.
I'm quite curious to know the KIT perspective on that question as well. Like, how do you think about the experience of, you know, I did the VR thing before, and it is a really special experience and really transports you into that world. But how much do you think about aesthetics, of your environment you're working in, of the simulations, of the experience?
That's a tough question. I'm also not speaking for KIT, I think, now. Yeah. I think KIT's view on aesthetics in buildings is probably not a topic we should discuss. I mean, we are living in, I mean, all the people that joined here from my group as well, we are not living in a very nice building, I would say. It's a rather old building. I think it does not play a super important role what the aesthetics of the place we are working at is. It plays a role where the experiments are, though. I mean, for example, my experiment is in Japan. This is very hard to reach, which is now a 14-hour flight. That makes it very difficult to get there. Going to CERN, for example, on the other hand, it's just a train right away. So these things play a role. But I think aesthetics itself is, at least not in our day-to-day discussion, an important topic. The communication is a very important aspect. The communication, but the communication is always international. To me personally, it is very important to deliver the message in a very clean way. I think a lot about how I deliver the message. I think the images we show, they are very strong. I mean, we condense work of 10,000 people over 20 years in one powerful image. I think my goal in such an audience is always to simplify it so that it does not become wrong, which, I mean, it's not meant as a joke. It's really hard to condense things so that whatever you say is still correct, because I mean, not just entertaining, there is still the scientific part.
I should like to extend the question. I was curious of the Bell Laboratory.
Okay, yeah, so I mean, this, I think, in for this particular one is really just meant as an outreach tool to explain how our detectors work. We realized, though, that in teaching, so even in our particle physics courses, this is very powerful. Even for our students, it's sometimes difficult to visualize these complicated topologies that you have seen on the VR headset in just a plain view on it on 2D. But even the experts here in the room, we really have to look by eye on many of these collisions to find patterns. By the way, I find it funny, nobody mentioned artificial intelligence so far. That's very rare. No, but this, I mean, this is, by the way, I'm not...
Ivory Tower.
So this is our day-to-day work. We develop AI tools, the most powerful you can think to analyze these structures, but first we need domain knowledge and human have to look at the things. It's not that AI can do the job for us. This is an important tool to visualize things for us. It's very hard to visualize these particle collisions, and 3D is much easier than 2D. I would like to visualize in 4D and 5D, but we are failing yet. Maybe the colleagues can help.
But how much data visualization is not only like mediation tool, but also epistemic tool? Is it also that precisely through the visualization, is it also you can like better develop some mathematical models? And
absolutely, yes. I think many of the things you actually, your brain will spot patterns looking at many of these events way before maybe you have a mathematical tool to really describe them. No, it's absolutely important. But not necessarily simplified VR things, but we have similar displays, typically a bit more technical, that we use on a day-to-day basis a lot.
Are there any further questions?
Last question maybe from my side. Do you think that digital marble is more sustainable than digital plastic?
It's really interesting. I mean,
it's
like,
birthday today.
I don't know how to, but it's actually a really good question. Depends on what more sustainable means in what regard. Yeah, because, well, depending on the algorithm, you could look at how much, one might use more carbon than the other in processing power. So anyway, but you could get down to that level. Yeah, but no, I like the question. I'm gonna think about it and get back to you.
Then, is there a further question?
No, I just wanted to say there are no more questions from the audience. So I think you're good to close the panel.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for all of you for being with us today, and thank you for joining the finissage of the exhibition Matter, Nonmatter, Antimatter. Thank you for joining us and listening to the presentation and possibly visiting the exhibition. And I would like to also thank the technical team who were with us, and not to forget the team of the exhibition, some of whom are still here, Felix Kolberstein, who co-curated the exhibition and kindly organized this weekend, and Marianne Schiedler, who was the managing editor around the whole process, and also Moritz Konrad, who already left, but he was also part of the curatorial team, and I'm very grateful that I could work with them. So thank you very much, and have a nice evening. And if you would like to, you can still visit the exhibition tomorrow. there will be running lectures from 11 by Stephan Schwingeler, and from 2 p.m. By Torben Ferber. Exactly, and they will enlighten different aspects of the exhibition based on their field. Let's see. Yes. So thank you, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.